Okay, speaking of ranking, it's my great pleasure to be able to announce our award winner today for the 15th Annual Personalized Medicine Conference. I really need to start by saying I think I am probably the luckiest person in the room today, having worked side by side with our esteemed honoree for more than three decades now. Dr. Shack has led the field of personalized medicine through his discovery and development of multiple breakthrough targeted therapies and precision diagnostics. In doing so, Steve has made an extraordinary impact on the global healthcare front, most importantly, the many patients and their families who have benefited from his tireless commitment to individualize the treatment of disease. After beginning his career as assistant professor of medicine and pharmacology at New York University School of Medicine, Steve joined Genentech, where he spent 14 years serving in various leadership roles in discovery research and clinical development. Among his many achievements, he directed the worldwide phase 3 clinical trials of Herceptin and successfully presented those results to the FDA in 1998. Further, Steve played a pivotal role in securing FDA approval of the Hercept test, a test critical in identifying patients with HER2 overexpression. No one would debate that Herceptin has changed the most feared form of breast cancer, HER2-positive disease, to the most treatable, providing a survival benefit to patients worldwide. Prior to his oncology work on both Herceptin and Avastin, Steve discovered and cloned the human DNase gene, leading to the development of the inhaled Pulmozyme drug, the first new treatment in over 30 years for the cystic fibrosis patients. Pulmozyme was approved by the FDA in 1993, and 25 years later is still a standard of care in CF treatment. With the use of Pulmozyme and inhaled antibiotics, the life expectancy for individuals with cystic fibrosis has increased from 27 to 45 years. Through his experience at Genentech, Steve realized the increasingly important role of diagnostics in personalizing cancer care, and in 2000 co-founded Genomic Health with the mission to transform cancer treatment by providing clinically actionable diagnostic tests to help physicians and patients make individualized treatment decisions. His goal was to change the one-size-fits-all paradigm of cancer diagnosis and treatment. Today, this award reflects his achievement of that goal. With only a handful of validated cancer biomarkers used in clinical practice and wide belief that accurately measuring RNA and DNA in fixed paraffin-embedded tumor was nearly impossible, Steve's vision was bold. However, after leading a team of scientists and discovering a novel method of using RT-PCR technology to reliably quantitate tumor gene expression for the first time in human cancers, Steve's vision became a reality. Under his leadership, Genomic Health developed the Oncotype IQ portfolio of genomic-based diagnostic tests and services that help physicians and patients make confident, personalized treatment decisions. They have been used by more than 53,000 physicians in 90 countries for treatment decision-making in more than 1 million patients, and importantly, saving healthcare systems worldwide more than $5 billion. Under Steve's guidance, Genomic Health has generated 125 clinical studies involving more than 140,000 patients. Most significantly, his leadership of the landmark NCI-sponsored TAILORx breast cancer trial established a new global standard of care and led to the distinction of being named one of the top medical advances in 2018 by the New England Journal of Medicine and the NCI. Steve's ideas continue to grow. He's now spearheading the generation of real-world clinical evidence with the establishment of a collaboration with the NCI SEER program to electronically supplement its registry with genomic information. In addition, Steve has driven the clinical development of a fully automated sample-to-answer IVD version of the Oncotype DX breast recurrence score with the aim of increasing global access for patients. Steve is truly a pioneer in personalized medicine who continues to blaze new frontiers. He constantly challenges the status quo in addressing the most critical clinical and scientific questions while continuing to inspire young scientists, patient advocates, colleagues, and industry peers. Steve's dedication to patients is only surpassed by his dedication to his family and colleagues. I can personally vouch for the deep respect and adoration he has for Gail, Josh, Linda, and Emma, and no one brightens his smile more than their beautiful granddaughter, Mary. I could go on and on with personal stories of Steve's generosity, caregiving, and just plain human kindness. He is all in all he does, and whatever it is, family, friendship, scientific discovery, or biking, he does it to make life better for all of us. I started by saying I'm the luckiest person in the room, and I have, as I have been the recipient of Steve's genius, not just once, but multiple times in bringing his life-changing innovation to patients around the world, and I'm even luckier to call Gail and Steve lifelong friends. And Steve, Pat phoned this morning, adamant that I share with you his congratulations on what is today our 38th wedding anniversary, and mentioned that he planned to call Gail to see if she was available for dinner tonight. So with that, I'd like you all to join me in congratulating our dear friend and esteemed colleague, Dr. Stephen Check.
Kim and my friend, thank you so much for your heartfelt comments. And I will have more to say about Kim later in my remarks. I am very honored and humbled by this award. I thank the Personalized Medicine Coalition, Ed Abrams, Kim Popovitz, and all the other members of this distinguished board for this recognition. And we all thank the PMC for supporting this new and so important field of personalized medicine. As I was preparing for today, one of my colleagues asked me, what was the best idea I ever had? And like all of us, I have had a lot of ideas at work, but then thinking more broadly, my best idea had to be marrying my wife, Gail. However, when I thought more about that, I remembered that getting married was actually not my idea. It was hers. And so, Gail, you know, you're here with me today. I want to thank you for that great first idea of getting married and for the 42 years that we have shared in our lives together. I am also so grateful every day to our two children, Linda and Josh, as well as Josh's wife Emma, and our first grandchild Miriam. You are clearly the joys of our lives and have been so supportive of both of us and our work. Linda, our oldest, has survived two cancer diagnoses, the first when she was 10 years of age. Only recently, she had admitted to herself and to us, and now to others, that she sees herself as a cancer survivor. And we admire her so much as we see her giving back as a volunteer for an amazing cancer nonprofit called First Descents. Take a look, they're really incredible. They provide the power of adventure experiences and connections to young people with cancer. I, like so many of you, know that personalized medicine is very personal. There is a famous saying that if you want to go fast, go alone, but if you want to go far, go together. Today, I want to acknowledge and thank the many individuals who played critical roles in developing and delivering Pulmozyme, Herceptin, and Oncotype to patients here in the US and all around the world. Today, I will also provide advice to you and to the field on how we can take personalized medicine farther and faster. My early training as a physician had an enormous influence on me. I thank the patients I served at Bellevue and at UCSF and the colleagues I served with who taught me so much when I was practicing medicine. I continue to be inspired by the patients who I cared for. A woman in her 30s came to the Bellevue emergency room late at night in 1977. She had had now several weeks of severe respiratory distress and what looked like, on the chest X-ray, a fatal and untreatable lung disease. When her blood test came back later that night, they hinted she might instead have a very rare and treatable diagnosis called eosinophilic pneumonia. If true, the specific treatment for that disease would melt away her lung abnormalities. I gave that treatment, and it truly was miraculous. It drove home a simple imperative. We needed to better understand and diagnose and treat everyone based on molecular insights and more targeted approaches. I left my home in academic medicine and joined industry in 1986 when I answered an ad in Science and took a position as a scientist in the molecular biology department of a young company called Genentech. I joined with the hopes and dreams of a young clinician scientist that I could work not just on small experiments, that either took advantage just of what I knew how to do or the amount of limited funding I had, but that I could work with others on big goals and really big ideas that might be impactful on patient lives. I was inspired by Bob Swanson and Herb Boyer, who founded Genentech and created the center of a new biotech industry that I am so proud to be part of. At Genentech, TPA for heart attacks was the biggest project at the time. It was in multiple clinical trials, and walking down the hall one day, I remembered patients at Bellevue with cystic fibrosis, struggling to breathe with their airways thick and filled with sputum. And I wondered whether, geez, there might be a human enzyme which, when inhaled, would go down and chop up those secretions, just like TPA was now being used to dissolve or lyse the clots in the coronary arteries. And so I went back to the old literature and rediscovered that there was an enzyme, DNase, that the human enzyme, DNase 1, had never been cloned. And I got the go-ahead from those great leaders at Genentech to drop everything and clone DNase, which I did in 1988. I added tiny amounts of that enzyme to a test tube with CF sputum. I watched as it liquefied that sputum within minutes. And yes, it is true. People keep telling me they remember this. It is true that I ran around to so many offices at Genentech with that tube of sputum and I was showing everyone what it looked like before and after DNase treatment. Without doubt, it was an incredible team of individuals at Genentech, at the CF Foundation, and at FDA that made it possible for the first new drug in CF to be approved worldwide in 1993, less than 5 years after conception of that idea. And I am so proud not only of the impact it's had on care, but also it laid the foundation for a commitment by the CF Foundation to invest in further drug development based on the cloning of the gene. And in fact, it's now 30 years ago to this year that the CF gene was cloned. And just 2 weeks ago, it was amazing to be at the CF Foundation meeting to hear about the new triple drug therapy, no doubt the best personalized medicine story this year, that is now capable of treating 90% of the kids and adults who have been diagnosed with that disease. I want to thank Bob Bell, who was the CEO of the foundation in those early years and saw that working with industry was going to be important for the kids. and for the foundation, the trial network set up, the importance of clinical trial networks that were set up by Bonnie Ramsey at the University of Washington, the actual FDA commissioner, David Kessler, who was a pediatrician and wanted to make sure that advances would also serve not only adults, but also kids. David Botstein, who was an amazing mentor to me and so many others. Art Levinson, who actually was spending his last year in the lab and had developed the Chinese hamster cell line that was able to manufacture the large amounts of DNAs that was required for CF. And then there are many unsung heroes, Bill Young and all those scientists and staff that developed that new technology. We tend to take it for granted. That ability to manufacture huge amounts of human proteins and thus to be able to serve patients all over the world with CF and with so many other diseases. Deservedly, the Lasker Award was given last month in New York City to Dennis Slamon from UCLA and to Mike Shepard and Axel Ulrich in Genentech for their role in the discovery of Herceptin, the humanized monoclonal antibody that targets HER2 that afflicts about 20% of all breast cancers. I had an amazing opportunity to lead the clinical team at Genentech, collaborating with Dr. Slamon and the worldwide group of investigators that were performing the pivotal trials to deliver those landmark results and then to bring those results that exceeded certainly mine and everybody's expectations for approval in 1998. As has been chronicled in many publications, including a great book by NBC's Bob Bazell and several movies, the Herceptin Project was almost killed many, many times, not just once. Most people never believed that a simple injected antibody alone could have any impact on a solid tumor, on metastatic breast cancer that had already been spread throughout the body. And yet the data and the results were amazing in showing that a simple antibody combined with chemotherapy could do exactly that. Dr. Slamon, who fought for his idea, taught me the importance of perseverance in championing innovation. It's not easy. There were so many others that worked to bring Herceptin to patients and to change HER2 positive disease. Specifically, I thank Larry Norton at Memorial Sloan Kettering for his insights and incredible advice, the leadership of oncology and product development provided by Sue Hellman at Genentech, who was amazing, and then many people in data management and biostatistics, Gracie Lieberman, and that incredible group that allowed us to know what we know about Herceptin, but also to know what we don't know. And ultimately, with regard to innovation, that is our job, and we do it great when we're able to provide that information from performing the right studies and getting that analysis right. In 2000, Randy Scott, Jeff Baker, and I started Genomic Health. At that time, the vast majority of patients with ER-positive breast cancer, the most common type, were treated with chemotherapy, even though we knew that only 4 out of 100 of them benefited. Today, more than 1 million patients have benefited from Herceptin, from Oncotype. The 21 gene assay we developed provides individual prognostic information, but also more importantly, information on who does and does not benefit from chemotherapy. And today, it's completely flipped. The vast majority of women can be effectively treated with hormone therapy alone, avoiding unnecessary chemotherapy and its toxicity and costs. Moreover, an important minority, and this is really important, we weren't necessarily finding the right patients to treat before. The Oncotype DX results can be used to find those patients who have a potentially life-preserving benefit of chemotherapy, knowing it is right for them. Innovative precision medicine advances, such as Oncotype, can both improve care and reduce costs. At Genomic Health, we listened to the patients and to the leaders in the cancer field. Dr. George Sled led us to our first clinical trial. And Dr. Cliff Huddis provided clinical comments that were always helpful to get before we made our final clinical study plans. Breast cancer advocates, including Fran Visco, Mary Lou Smith, Elda Raley, and Dr. Susan Love, urged us to get better answers and to do it right. We listened and we did it right. I thank Norm Walmark and Soon Paik at NSABP, Kathy Albane, Gabe Hortabaji, and Bill Barlow at SWOG, Lori Habel at the Kaiser Permanente Division of Research for collaboration and clinical studies that were critical to its development. Oncotype DX was new and innovative in so many ways, and yes, as something new and innovative, there were so many obstacles to overcome. It was not easy either. Randy Scott, a recognized leader in genomics and personalized medicine, recognized by, you know, this coalition, I can't thank Randy enough for his leadership and guidance. Randy, as if you've ever met him, as you know, is a true visionary. He is fearless, and he helped me and so many others to be more courageous and to follow our convictions. And he also ensured, and this isn't unimportant, that we actually had the funding to be able to do it right. We forget today, in a world where whole genome sequencing is performed daily on formalin fixed tumor blocks, that in 2000, virtually no one even thought that you could study DNA or RNA in fixed tumors. Geoff Baker led the team at Genomic Health, along with Maureen Cronin, to develop the quantitative PCR assay to unlock the block, to reveal quantitative expression for multiple genes. That was really important, right? Before that, we looked at genes one at a time, ER, PR, HER2, but now, all of a sudden, and it was incredible, we could look at multiple genes in a way that was never done before. I felt, in looking at our early data, like we had a new molecular microscope that allowed us to see cancer for the first time in an entirely new way. We also innovated in performing clinical trials. We pioneered the concept of doing prospective, retrospective clinical trial designs, bringing the rigor of drug development to diagnostic development. Together with the leaders of the SEER program at NCI, again, Lynn Penberthy and Valentina Petkoff are such incredible and visionary leaders for that organization. We shared the Oncotype DX results. We were just talking about sharing data and the importance of transparency. We volunteered the results from our clinical laboratory that we had performed over the last 14 years with that program so that SEER could have a public treasure, a SEER genomic database, in order to learn about the use of a new intervention and cancer outcomes in the real world. This groundbreaking collaboration between industry and government yielded much important new information, including new results for very young patients with breast cancer, and also many older patients with breast cancer, subgroups that are often not represented and not enrolled in clinical research. Finally, we are so proud to have been part, as Kim said, of the NCI-sponsored clinical trial, which was reported last year. And Dr. Joe Sperano, who was at the dinner last night, began an effort in 2005 to use Oncotype in order to definitively define, in a prospective study, who needs chemotherapy. He led the NCI-sponsored trial, the largest ever breast cancer treatment trial, enrolling over 10,000 patients to a successful conclusion in 2018. The results had an impact all around the world, and it has never been clearer who needs and who does not need chemotherapy. We have transformed chemotherapy into a targeted drug for breast cancer. So many individuals and groups at Genomic Health contributed to these innovations. In particular, thank you to Mike Walker, Drew Watson, Marty Haskins, and a special shout out to Rick Boehner. He's here in the audience. Rick, a pathologist, was involved and played a key role in our first studies that critically actually showed that molecular insights went beyond what we could do with the best available pathology techniques. He became then the head of pathology and currently is our chief medical officer. Thank you, Rick. Thank you to John Cassell, Irene Chen, and actually the assistants we get to do everything that we do, Carrie Loki, my executive assistant, and others. They also are key and critical too as part of the team. The amazing commercial, finance, and legal teams at Genomic Health were outstanding, and I particularly thank Laura Lieber, who's here today, and her communications team, including Sarah Chenault and Emily Fawcett. We do need to communicate what we do. It's sometimes very complicated, and it's hard work to translate that into simple language so that people can really understand what personalized medicine is all around. Thank you so much for collaborating, not only in communicating our results, but also in involving the advocacy community in everything that we do. And I know we stand up there with their support, and it's invaluable. We had the support also of our board of directors. It was particularly important in the early days with the insights and contributions of Brooke Byers, Sam Colella, Fred Cohn, Michael Goldberg, who's currently on the board of the PMC, as well as Julian and Felix Baker. And then Kim. Kim has led Genomic Health as CEO for the last 12 years. You are my hero. I know I speak for all of us at Genomic Health that your leadership and the culture that you created were critical for us to be able to transform and translate the science that we do into improvements in cancer care. You are, and you could tell when she was presenting, always so authentic. You are also amazingly strong and powerful. And you use your strength on behalf of all of us at Genomic Health and the patients and the physicians we serve, which is why we follow you. I also thank you for your excitement and your tireless efforts to bring about the recent merger of Genomic Health with Exact Sciences. We are all excited about bringing that combination together in order to create and accelerate the development of new diagnostics in the future. Finally, your work with the coalition, with Ed, with industry and policy experts around the world in communicating the incredible value of personalized medicine has really made a difference. Looking forward, there are some undeniable facts. Not all patients are the same. All drugs are targeted. For most, though, we have not yet identified the precision tools we need to provide those insights. It is very humbling for me to realize how hard it is to pick the next Herceptin. I did not think years ago that lung cancer and melanoma would now be so treatable in many cases. Nevertheless, even though none of us are very good at predicting what are going to be the breakthroughs in the next few years, in my mind, there is no doubt that there will be advances in personalized medicine that are unstoppable and we will experience in the next few years unanticipated delights with more breakthroughs in cancer prevention, in diagnosis, and in treatment. However, for our patients today, for those that are diagnosed tomorrow, for those that are diagnosed the day after tomorrow, those advances are not being, they don't occur fast enough. Moreover, those advances are often not prescribed according to best practice, as we just saw in the last talk. And for many, access to healthcare in general is lacking. While we can always benefit from more funding and new technologies, the most important point I want to make is that the ingredient that really matters is people. In all of our institutions, the ingredient that matters walks in with 2 feet in the morning and they go home with 2 feet in the evening and they don't need to come back. People make the difference. There are also no actual walls that separate academia, industry, advocates, and government. There are no walls. Those silos, and I know we all experience them, have walls only in our minds and in the culture that we create. To optimally innovate and deliver the promise of personalized medicine, we need more precision leadership, and it was on your slide, and we need more precision teamwork. And what do I mean by precision leadership and precision teamwork? Precision leadership and precision teamwork, we've seen it, and you all probably have seen examples. I certainly remember seeing it when Kennedy made a bold commitment to go to the moon, and then a man landed on the moon in less than a decade. A couple of weeks ago, the Blue Angels were flying over the skies of San Francisco, and it's precision leadership and precision teamwork that keeps those incredibly complex airplanes flying fast and safe in formation. And at the best times, the advances of Oncotype, Herceptin, and Pulmozyme occurred when we really did work together. Too many patients today don't experience this. They experience fragmented care and treatment that does not incorporate the state of the art. So I have 4 requests based on the values. Actually, I got advice that if you can make it simpler, it's better, and so I reduced it to 3. I didn't, and nothing, and it's still just as good. So I have 3 requests. Yeah. Based on the values we have treasured at Genomic Health for the last 19 years. This is what all of us must do better. First, winning, the value of winning and being ahead of the curve. Winning really does matter. Our time is our greatest resource. And I found that you do not increase your chances of success by trying to do lots of things at once, which I know I am and we're all prone to do. Select your highest priorities, a few things. Work on a smaller number of them that are really big, really bold, and important from a patient-centered perspective. Be bold and also take the time to work with your colleagues and with the doctors and patients you hope to serve to develop a detailed and thought-out approach and plan with the end in mind. It will evolve, and that's okay. However, as my favorite philosopher, Yogi Berra, once said, if you don't know where you're going, you'll be lost when you get there. Isn't that so true for genomics? Make sure you really understand the job to be done. Big innovations in personalized medicine do not happen by accident, and it is hard. Do the hard work. Second, the value of truth-seeking. Let's all continue to experiment and we sometimes are stuck in a rut and we do things always the same way. Let's experiment with doing different roles and different tasks, and let's continue to learn about what we are great at and what we like to do. I've seen on our teams when people are doing and when they have the job that draws on their strengths and is what they like to do, magic happens. Be honest with yourself with regard to what you really like to do and what you're good at, and then do it. Know your strengths and take advantage of them, and try to become acquainted, and it's so hard, with your blind spots. Use that inward knowledge of your strengths and blind spots to aggressively and more precisely seek advice and collaboration with others. The enemy of innovation is not ignorance. It's rather the illusion that we already know the answer. Combine that with our human tendency to stay attached to our own beliefs, whether false or true, so often leads us to lose those key chances to see unexplored avenues and innovative ideas. I've learned I sometimes miss those chances 5 times a day. Don't miss any of them. Third and finally, the last value is community. This is probably most important. Look to give inspiration and important roles to others every day if you can. We all perform optimally when our job takes advantage of our skills and our strengths, and when our job and what others challenge us to learn and to grow. Let's make each other great in pursuit of our goals. Put people and patients first. When faced with a problem, whatever it is, develop those relationships and invent solutions together where we all win. We all win on behalf of patients. I am so indebted, finally, to the patients that participated in the clinical trials. The Pulmozyme clinical trials, the Herceptin clinical trials, and the trials that led to the development of Oncotype, like the NSABP B14 trial, the trial that validated the Oncotype DX assay that used tissue from women that participated in a clinical trial in the 1980s. They volunteered their tissue for research, and I have no doubt if they knew, they would be so proud to know that the tissue that they volunteered in the 1980s is now helping their daughters and women throughout the world that they never knew get a better treatment today. This is just the beginning of personalized medicine. The job that I'm doing now did not exist when I was in training. The discipline of genomics did not exist when I was in training. And you're all the next generation, whether young in age or older, are training and developing your skills for jobs in personalized medicine, for disciplines in personalized medicine that do not exist today. We saw those gaps. There is nothing more exciting and more important than that. And so let's all look to give others opportunities to contribute every day so that we all win for the benefit of the patient. Thank you. Yeah.
What was the hardest thing that you had to do to get public adoption?
Oh.
A new new diagnosis?
The question was, what was the hardest thing we had to do to get public adoption? I think the hardest thing was the fact that it was almost impossible. And I think many, many of you and many of us experiencing that, that when it comes to changing the behavior of physicians, my colleagues that I love, when it comes to getting paid in the modern world, where unfortunately, diagnostics are not given a fair shake compared to therapeutics or drugs, it's super hard. And I wouldn't underestimate that ultimately it's about people, and it's about having the resources and the people in your organization, and then reaching out to more relationships to actually win over those people who were initially your biggest critics. And so I think that's really an important lesson. When we first submitted our application to CMS to get Medicare approval, it came back in less than a month, and it was devastating. The key to the company was getting that approval, and there was a devastating letter that said that in no way, no how, was this going to be approved. And we sort of sat back, and a couple of ideas were floated. Let's send them back, and an angry letter or whatever. Kim, you remember that? We thought about it and realized that it was really a very smart pathologist that had looked at the data, that in their rejection they had asked a bunch of questions and were interested in getting more information. And then we reached out to all the experts that we had worked with in order for them to share more information with that one individual who's going to make the decision. And true story, it was about a month later, I got an email. It just popped up on my computer. I almost thought, by the way, when I read it, that it was a hoax, saying that we were now approved and that we were cleared for Medicare reimbursement throughout the United States. I remember, to Kim's office and Randy's office to show her the email. So there are many stories like that. I think one of the things we can do as we go forward, since it is so hard, as I said, if we go back to my three requests, is just think about how we can help each other. And if we're stuck and if we're getting resistance, someone else might have thought about how to address that or how to solve that, or might know someone that can help us, get that job done. Don't rely on yourself alone. Thanks. Thank you.